This month's giveaway is a $10 gift card for your choice of PSN, Xbox Marketplace, Nintendo eShop, or Steam. How do you enter to win? It's simple. All you have to do is be a subscriber. Would you want additional entries? Then all you have to do is leave a comment on any of our full-length podcast videos for this month. The winner will be chosen at the end of the month. Good luck, and thank you for watching.
Broussard.
Just yeah, Broussard. B-R-O-U-S-S. You want me to write it down for you or you got it?
No, I got it.
Say it one more time.
Broussard.
Yeah, you got it wrong again. Brewski. Let's go.
What is it?
No, it's fine.
What is it?
It's French, man. You're never going to get it. Bruce. I promise you, you'll never say it right.
Broussard.
But sure, that's fine.
What is it?
No, that's how everybody says it. That's fine.
Yeah, how do you say it?
Broussard.
You're saying the same thing as me.
That's what you think. Just continue.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Press X Podcast, Episode 9, your weekly podcast for gaming news and opinions. I'm Kevin McManus. This is Kellen Willard.
What's up?
And for the first time ever, we have a third person on the podcast, Todd Broussard.
Hey, guys. Good to be here today.
Todd, tell us about yourself. What do you do?
What's going on, man? Right now, I'm a student at UTC.
All right. That's exciting.
Not
yep.
really.
And
what about gaming? What do you do gaming-wise? It's almost like this is a gaming podcast.
For sure. Playing a lot of Smite right now.
Oh, yeah. I promised that we would have Todd on the show, and we were going to do an episode all devoted to MOBAs. I think I said that like 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Not this episode. We'll do it some other time. Yeah. No MOBAs.
MOBAs to be continued.
Yeah. So lots of Smite.
Lots of Smite.
Where can people watch you play Smite?
You can follow Odd Dog Todd on Twitch.
Great name.
Sweet
that
name.
Rolls off the tongue.
Oh, yeah.
Easy to say.
For sure. Playing a lot of Smite. Just recently bought the new Call of Duty. It's fine.
Yeah, it's okay.
It's not bad. It's fine for Call of Duty. It's a fun shooter game.
Mm-hmm.
Been getting a little killer instinct.
It's a good one.
It's sweet.
We played that.
Not my favorite fighting game, but it's cool.
It's all right.
Yeah. It's actually pretty mediocre.
Yeah.
But it's pretty.
Cool characters.
Yeah.
Fighting game is pretty
mediocre.
Yeah. It is pretty.
So today we're going to be talking about Uncharted 4's delay. We're going to be talking about the Nintendo Direct that we all watched. That was a mixture of exciting and lots of lackluster.
Yeah, lot of lackluster.
Some weird decisions.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on at Nintendo, and I never do. We're going to be talking about No Man's Sky, which finally got a release date, as well as some things I'm inferring from interviews I've watched about it.
Okay.
And we're going to talk about why I'm mad at GameStop. Because...
You're always mad at GameStop.
I'm not always mad at GameStop, just every time I actually go into the building, I'm mad at them. Or try to use their online store. But we'll
just mad at the world, Kevin.
I know. I'm just an angry person. So we're going to talk about that. And I wanted to give a shout out to the winner of the giveaway, Joshua Maria. I sent you a message for your contact information. So check your inbox and get back to me, and I can ship out that Mighty Number 9. Are we ready to begin the news?
I think we're ready to go.
Sure.
Very excited. Number one. Gosh, this setup is awful. I'm crowded. Paper, everything's in the way.
Your idea.
It was my idea. It was a poor one. It was a last minute decision. Let's be honest here. Todd's like, I'm coming over, and I'm like, you could be on the podcast.
It's the story of my life. I'm the last minute decision. That's what my parents tell me every night.
Todd just shows up. It's like the most unwelcoming comment. Oh, guess we have to deal with this one. The PSP store is shutting down March 31st. While this means you won't be able to purchase from the store, you will be able to download your licensed games, purchase from the web browser, and in-game purchases will still work. So the PSP has been going strong for years and years and years, and I'm actually surprised it took this long for them to finally shut down the store. But I think this is the first major console that's hooked to online to have its store shut down.
Yeah, I can agree, yeah.
You can still buy the games on like the PS3 and do the transfer to get them onto your PSP, etc. But this kind of brings up the idea of digital games are renting. Like you're borrowing the game, and eventually all of those services are going to go down and your PSP is going to break or whatever.
Right.
You're going to buy a new one.
Right.
And it's going to be worthless.
Oh, yeah.
Except for your physical games. So something like the PSP Go, which is digital only, won't be able to, it'll be a brick, basically.
It'll be a paperweight, yeah.
Yeah. So any thoughts on the PSP? Anybody have a PSP? Anybody use a PSP?
I had a PSP. When they first came out, I got a PSP.
How'd you like that?
I mean, it was interesting, but I was, like, really into my my Game Boy, so I, like, just never picked up my PSP, ended up selling
it. I was so excited when the PSP came out, and I bought one. I think I own two games that I've never beaten, and I own three movies, and one of them was the Family Guy, like, the Untold Stewie Griffin story or whatever on the UMD discs.
Right.
Universal Media. Yeah. They're universal. You can use them on anything. They work.
Just the PSP.
And I watched that like 18 times because that was the only thing I used the device for.
Nice.
And a lot of people love the PSP and it sold really well. It sold actually way more than people think.
Did very well,
And the games didn't. And the reason for that is you could hack the PSP and play emulators on it. It was one of the best machines for emulators.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, well, I'll turn mine into an emulation machine, and I bricked it. So I don't actually... I have a PSP. Doesn't do anything.
You shouldn't have bricked it.
I wasn't trying to. I swear I didn't do it on purpose.
That's a bummer.
Yeah, it's just sitting in my closet.
Sounds about right for you, though.
That's right. All right. Speaking of Sony ending things, PlayStation TV has now officially been discontinued, or the Vita TV as it's known in Japan. So the sales for this thing were awful. We're talking like hundreds a month. Like, it, just real, real bad. You can pick it up for $20, $30 now if you you do some looking. I got one the day it came out. You don't have a Vita, and it's your only way to play Vita games.
I love the thing. I think it's awesome.
Yeah, I love it too. I think it's great. The problem is it's very much an accessory to...
Yeah.
Well, it's an accessory, and I don't think they, like, advertised it well.
They didn't advertise it.
Yeah.
They didn't support it.
Yeah.
Like, they didn't even put Netflix on it.
Yeah.
Who buys... Because when it came out, I was like, oh, this is going to compete with the Apple TV.
Right.
You can play games on... It's an Apple TV that plays games.
Yeah, it's sweet.
And then I hooked it up day one, and I was like, Hulu... All right, and like, there's just nothing on the device.
Yeah, it felt like someone, like, you know, came up with a sweet idea at PlayStation, and then they were just like, "Yeah, this is fine," and they just kind of shipped it out. They didn't put any thought into it, but it could have been sweet. Like,
yeah,
a lot
it really could have
actually, like, ended up being.
And it plays most Vita games very, very well. They look great on the TV. Something like Killzone looks like a PS3 game.
That's
it's
sweet.
Actually, incredible. The device is this big.
Yeah, that was how I played Persona. So.
It's super teeny. Yeah, I played Persona 3 completely through on it. I played all the Danganronpas on it. I love the thing. I paid $100 for it, and that was totally worth it for me.
Yeah.
But you can pick it up now for $30
super
and buy
cheap.
A memory card for like
$30.
Because the memory cards are more expensive than the actual consoles.
Than the device, yeah.
And then, so they're probably going to start disappearing off the shelves very soon. So if you wanted one, you better hurry up. This news kind of depressed me. Call of Duty Ghosts 2 is the rumored new Call of Duty game coming in November. Nobody liked Ghosts.
No.
Does anybody know anyone that enjoyed Call of Duty Ghosts?
Like, I was a diehard Call of Duty fan forever. And I didn't even buy it. It's the only Call of Duty I've never bought. That's how bad it was. Like, it's terrible.
Yeah, I never played it.
So all I heard about that one was how bad the levels were. Like
the maps are terrible.
And that's the first Call of Duty where I actively saw everybody go, let's just play Black Ops 2 or whatever one. Was it Black Ops or Advanced?
Advanced Warfare, yeah.
Everybody's Warfare. Just like, let's just play this one instead and skip the new
we
Call
just
of
skip,
Duty.
Everybody skipped Ghost, essentially. Even in MLG, they were trying to play Advanced Warfare over Ghost.
Yeah, nobody liked that game.
Yeah.
It was bad.
A lot of people complained about the maps. I think it was that they were too big and there was lots of camping going on.
These are awful maps. And then the gun balancing in the game is the worst gun balancing they've ever had. They had like six different patches trying to balance guns and stuff. It's crazy.
So hopefully it's not true. But we might have Call of Duty Ghosts 2, which would be very interesting because Black Ops 3 was the best-selling Call of Duty.
Oh, that's crazy.
It was insane.
It's very well made for like a shooter.
And then this might honestly be the worst one.
It's
going to
be trash.
Follow it up.
Yeah,
so.
I don't know why they're doing it.
Open terribly for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, terribly. It's still going to be the number one game.
Yeah,
but
for Call of Duty.
Yeah, for Call of Duty, I'm going to make a bold prediction right here because my predictions are always right.
Yeah.
And I'm saying that this one's going to launch with the lowest sales of any of the last five.
Last 5 years, yeah.
I knew they were working on World of War II.
Really?
Because
I would play that.
I would buy that one.
I think they're like taking their time on it, so we might see it next year.
That's something else I wanted to talk to you guys with. we've been in this modern setting for shooters, really.
Yeah.
And like almost future.
Almost semi futuristic.
Like the Titanfalls and all that stuff.
Yeah.
What setting do we want? Do we like the setting? Do we want to go back to World War II, like the World at War? Do we want to go further? Like, there is rumors that the new Battlefield is World War I, which makes no sense.
No, it doesn't. World War I.
Awesome.
It's really boring.
It's like, they're getting gassed.
So, so like, just like awful. Looking at cells, like, most modern warfare games do, like, fine. And then, like, the semi-futuristic, like, slash futuristic shooter games do, like, really well.
Just,
so I think
yeah.
people really enjoy like that aspect of it.
That's
you know?
Fair. I think people are turned off by World War II settings. Mm-hmm. And like I know I am.
Yeah.
I just don't like that.
Like
setting.
World of War did not do well at first.
I liked World of War a lot, but
people
setting
like it now,
I didn't like that setting at all.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm wanting it just because we've been so
for
far
sure.
away from
it's
it.
It's
but
so
at
fresh
the time
right
when
now.
It came out, I was like, yeah, I'm gonna play Call of Duty 4.
Yeah.
Play Modern Warfare.
Modern Warfare.
I like
was
the World War II setting.
A lot of people didn't like it on release, but I mean, I liked
that was,
it.
That was
I would
one of my favorite Call of Duty,
yeah,
actually.
I agree. It's really good.
I would enjoy going back to it for sure.
I could see that.
Yeah, we
sure.
hadn't seen that in a while. So,
So Sony's been... There's a lot of Sony news in this episode, and this is another like weird mistake for Sony. Super Stardust HD was not the free PlayStation Plus game that was released this month, despite being announced. So when it launched and the PlayStation Plus games went live... I Am Alive was the free game, and everybody was real confused.
What a goof.
Yeah, and then as of like 4 days ago, they took that down and put Super Stardust up. So if you reacted in time, you got both games free, so that's pretty sweet. I seem to remember something similar happening, maybe not last month, but the month before, where they announced a game, and then like the day before, they switched it, and I thought it was for this game as well, that I Am Alive. I don't know if this is like their placeholder game for PlayStation Plus or whatever when the other ones aren't ready. But yeah, so they messed up. But you could have got both games, so that's cool.
I didn't.
I guess.
Super Stardust is a good game.
Haven't played it.
It's very fun. Mass Effect. This is one that hits home for all three of us, I guess. Mass Effect has been delayed officially until early 2017, so it's looking like we'll get it in probably not January, but February or March.
Called it.
You did. I need somebody to go back and get all the predictions that we made and just give us a list of them so I can keep up with.
I'm a little excited about this just because
about it being delayed.
BioWare has not delayed games before, and they've come out really mediocre.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
So I'm hoping they're taking their time with this. People are really looking forward to the new Mass Effect.
Well, they got so much good press from 3.
Yeah.
Or terrible press, whichever.
That's very, very true. And also their, what was it, their the head of the project or whatever left within
the
past.
Director.
Yeah, within the past month. Mm-hmm. So they might have been pushed back a little bit by that. But they seem, because even in that announcement that they had a few weeks ago, they said that the game was set to come out up until early 2017. They didn't give specifics, and now it's still in the same slot that they allowed
originally.
It. So do we think it's going to get delayed again, or is it actually coming out early 2017?
I think we'll see it early 2017.
Yeah.
Maybe March-ish.
Sure. I could see March for sure.
Yeah, I think
probably
if it comes
not
out.
Earlier than that.
No, it could be late February, but yeah, I could see it in March. I kind of feel like it's going to get delayed again, though. There's something deep down inside that I'm like, this game is going to get delayed again, and we're not going to see it. So what are we looking forward to playing in that time frame where it was supposed to come out, that like November area? Is there anything that comes to mind?
Not really.
Not off the top of my head.
So we have a lot of games I don't think have been announced and or don't have release dates, but we can make some assumptions.
Right.
Something like Horizon. From PlayStation. I think
that
is their November game.
Right.
Yeah, I hope so.
Xbox Gears of War 4 is their November game.
Yeah.
Gears of War, your favorite franchise.
Yeah, man.
Not a big Gears of War fan.
It's fine.
Yeah.
Fantastic storylines. Like, some of the best shooter storylines you'll ever play through.
I was like, on the game. And then I saw the gameplay, and I was like, that looks kind of cool.
It's fine.
Yeah.
I mean, if you like rolling around back and forth and trying to fire a gun like a gorilla, then it's fun, but... If you like playing actual shooters, then it's pretty.
The new South Park game is supposed to come out in November.
That's a game I was real surprised at.
Fractured Butthole.
Yes. The South Park game was the actually best name ever really good.
Yeah, South Park's sweet. I need to play through that completely.
It's very fun. Very fun. And it's not only comical, it's just like a well made game.
Yeah. I'm so surprised they're doing a second one for that too. Because they absolutely hated making that game. They've openly stated how much they hate it and how they'll never do it again.
Yeah.
And they came out on stage and they're like, "We think we figured it out, so we're doing another one."
I think it did well.
It did really well.
Yeah.
And what they figured out was that
it only closed down one studio and got auctioned off. It's cool.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Whoops.
R.I.P. THQ. So Mass Effect wasn't the only game delayed. Uncharted 4 has been delayed again. Is this the third time we've seen this game delayed?
At least, yeah.
So it was an April 26th game, and now we're going to see it in
May. Do we know
May
what this delay was about?
10th. They talked about it. So they said that the delay was because it's a worldwide launch.
Right, which is not the easiest to do.
No one's getting it earlier, and they said that it was a manufacturing issue.
That
makes sense. So maybe some version of the game with subtitles or something.
Right.
There was something that they needed to do to it. My conspiracy theory is that last week we talked about how they put out the trailer and it had Assassin's Creed art in the, and they had to take it down.
Yeah,
that's probably just in the
and
game.
Apologize. So my conspiracy theory was that whoever put that art into the game, they went and talked to him, and they're like, "What else did you do?" And they had to go in and get rid of every single thing that he put into the game and change it for something else.
Ezio's just in the game.
Yeah. He's just one of the characters. He's actually in Final Fantasy 13 too. So,
pretty sweet.
I hate both of you so much. This one was something special. Microsoft revealed a trailer for a new HoloLens game, which is an awesome device, called Young Conker, and it features Conker from Rare, which is a company now owned by Microsoft. The video on YouTube has 1,317 likes and 20,363 dislikes.
That's impressive.
That is impressive. This video has Conker. We all know Conker for being a trash-talking, drunk, platformer. He's almost like a parody of cutesy platform games.
Yeah.
And in this, he's just a cutesy platform guy. And he looks awful.
He does.
Why would they do that?
I don't know. See, the thing is, if this was the first time this happened, it would be like, okay. But Microsoft did this with Banjo. Another Rare property, and everybody lost their mind and sent death threats to them. Hated it. And I just don't understand how Microsoft could be like, "Let's do it again."
I don't know. Banjo was a little worse, but I don't know. Making the same mistake again twice is crazy.
The thing is, Banjo, they redid him and it wasn't good, but at least it was trying to follow in the footsteps of Banjo. It's what might have been next. Yeah. This is totally different.
It's like a revamp, kind of.
Yeah, this is just Conker not acting like Conker, doesn't look like Conker, and he's called Conker because they own him.
They just want to use the name. Probably this game is probably something else at some point.
Yeah, it's actually really neat. So it uses HoloLens, which is the augmented reality headset that Microsoft's working on, which I'm actually getting more and more intrigued by as I see more videos. The problem is, much with VR, I've used VR. I like VR.
Right.
But it's hard to tell somebody why they should like VR unless they've used it. Yeah. Because it's so different.
It's a very different experience.
So HoloLens, I watch people use it and I'm like, that looks amazing. There's no way it works that. So it's something that I feel like I'm going to have to use before I can get an opinion.
If we just look at any cool Microsoft product that we thought was going to be sweet on release.
Oh, remember how the Kinect scans your skateboard into it and then you can play with it in the game?
Oh, if the Kinect was what it was on the
when they revealed
the tease trailers trailers, it'd just be the sweetest thing ever.
I probably would have.
Now I can't even turn my Xbox on.
So for people who don't know, the HoloLens is an augmented reality. So you can see your own world, but it puts virtual stuff in it basically. And the way the Conker game works is it's a platformer. You're jumping and collecting coins, very Mario-like.
Yeah.
Except it molds to the environment that you're in, so you can play the same level in different rooms, and it would act like a different level. And he's running on your table and then jumping on your cabinet. So it's cool. I want to try it.
Yeah.
But using Conker and doing that to them was just hilarious. Yeah. I've almost never seen a bigger outcry on my Twitter feed than Young Conker being revealed.
It sucks.
It's pretty funny. Activision is skipping having a booth at E3 2016. They normally have a huge booth.
Yep.
They're not going to be there. EA also dropped out of E3. Now Activision is. What's happening, and what is E3 becoming?
Not sure. It's looking more and more like a console kind of thing, to me anyways.
Well, I mean, Activision does. You mean just the major
like
console
Sony
developers.
Yeah.
Well, Bethesda's coming back, which was bizarre, too.
Surprising,
I
yeah.
think they're getting, like obviously E3's always had, like, some smaller, like, gaming companies, but I'm sure they'll, like, get more now. You know what I'm saying?
I hope so. Yeah, just they're going to have a big show for
just
because
things like
emptiness.
Activision and EA would take up so much of E3.
They do take up
yeah,
so much. Like, on the
like
floor,
so
they take
much
up
of it.
A lot
so
of room.
This gives
the
a lot
booths.
Of room for so.
Which costs money. It's why I think they're dropping out. So.
Yeah. I mean, they have the money to spend, but yeah,
they can do the same thing cheaper, though.
Yeah.
Also, their games are going to like, honestly, their games are going to sell. We know we're going to see the new Call of Duty on the PlayStation stage, and that's all they need.
Yeah.
Literally
sure, yeah.
all they need
yeah.
to do. So. Yeah, is this a problem? See, like, I'm thinking E3 is closed to the public. You can't just
right.
go in. And a lot of the,
right.
like, EA is doing a place away from E3 that you can go that is public.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking maybe that's the problem. They want, like, more of a public setting. They want more people to be able to play the games than
right.
just, like, the press and
yeah,
people that have been invited.
That's very fair.
I don't know, but if companies keep doing this, I don't know what E3 is going to...
I mean,
come later.
Open back up to the public.
Nintendo maybe. Might not be there as well. They weren't there for the last 2 years.
Yeah, that's
so,
true.
I don't know.
I don't get that because, like,
they have
I'm
a
not
console to show off.
Like, I'm not gonna like venture out to find like these, you know, EA exclusive things. You know, like E3 is sweet. The way they
right.
set it up is great. You know, it's very professional.
Yeah,
it's fun.
I mean,
watch.
E3. I literally take off work to
yeah,
watch.
Yeah, it's
E3.
Fantastic. You know,
I love
and
it.
I don't. You know, Activision and EA are fine. But I'm not going to, like, venture out to find out, you know,
yeah.
what they're doing
yeah, I'm
by
not
themselves.
Going looking for EA.
Yeah.
You
it's
look
crazy.
At the top-selling games any year. You can just pick a modern year of gaming, and there's at least three EA games
crazy.
And
Madden,
three Activision games.
Yeah.
At least one of them is mediocre.
It's always Skylanders
yeah, it's
and
crazy.
Call of Duty.
It's crazy.
So this is an interesting one. So Phil Spencer, head of Xbox, talked about making the Xbox consoles into something more upgradable. So he wasn't very specific, but he said that this is something he's been looking into. So it can go two ways. It can either be like the N64, which had the little RAM...
a little expansion on
expansion?
Top.
Yeah. Yeah, sorry. That let you play like Donkey Kong and some other games.
Right.
Or it can be like Nintendo's 3DS, where they put out the new 3DS and it had like exclusive games for it. Or a lot of people liken it to a phone, I guess, where it plays the same things, but one phone's just faster and brighter and
it's just
better.
I mean, it's essentially going to be like a desktop. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So I hate this idea.
I agree.
Okay.
It's like the reason for like having a console over computer.
Exactly. That. Thank you. That was my point. The reason I play on console primarily is because when I play on PC, things crash. I can't get things working.
Yeah.
Like my monitors start flickering. I'm like, what is going on?
Well, if you knew what you were doing, that
would be a problem. I have no clue what I'm doing, but I can have no clue what I'm doing and plug in my Xbox and it plays my game.
It's kind of nice. Like depending on like how much they do with it, like game developers will be able to make like really sweet games for the consoles.
So
like,
see, I'm thinking the opposite. I think it's going to hurt game developers because now they're going to have to work on versions for the game that either are going to be exclusive to even less people, so
mm-hmm.
it's like people that own the Xbox and then people that have that particular
right.
upgrade or whatever
right.
it is, or they're gonna have to hurt their other versions of the game. It's almost like when you play Tomb Raider on the
yeah.
Xbox One and
yeah.
you play it on the Xbox 360 because
yeah.
it's on both or Titanfall or whatever. Those are drastically different games even though
right.
they're the same game.
Right.
So I'm scared it would do that. Nobody's really tried anything to mass scale. I think the new 3DS is the closest example.
Yeah.
Well, remember Genesis had the 32X expansion.
Mm-hmm.
I actually had one of those. It was kind of cool.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh. I didn't know that. I always forget that
so
you liked Sega.
So
you're
like
a Sonic kid.
A
you're
Sega
so
kid.
So like one
you're
big
so
thing.
Weird.
You know, I used to be like a big PC player. So, like upgrading my PC all the time to like be able to play new games on like highest graphics and stuff. And that's like really annoying, you know. Like you start, it just gets crazy.
I haven't
like,
had to open my computer in a couple of years, so.
Well, that's fair. That once you get to a certain point, you don't have to do that anymore. But like the initial like cost to like boot it up to that grade. So I hope that doesn't happen with the console, because
it
like,
was real expensive to get.
Oh, it's crazy.
Yeah, I don't think it'll be that expensive. Like the only thing that I can see them doing is doing like Nintendo did, but having some sort of like trade-in program, kind of like your phone has, mm-hmm. where it's like I give you my old Xbox.
Yeah.
You give me this new one for $150.
Yeah.
And then next year, I'll pay another $150 to get the next one. You know what
the
I mean?
The only reason I could see it doing like I was talking about earlier is just because they've like. Been trying to match like the Windows 10 with like the Xbox One up much.
That's the thing they're gonna
do. So it feels like they're just trying to turn the Xbox One into a desktop, but like, but like product it as a console.
Yeah, which is not gonna be.
Yeah, it's like it's gonna be a shitty desktop they do that.
Yeah, they're gonna get a lot of backlash. That if that's
I don't think it's a good idea.
I thought that was interesting though. They're kind of like I know Sony's talked about doing that and stuff, but the overall opinion on it, or so it seemed, was that you're going to divide your audience
and it's crazy.
Confuse people.
Oh,
like grandma's going to go into the store looking to buy an Xbox and there's going to be three of them.
It's
and
very
like
crazy.
One's worse than the other.
Yeah.
But this one's got this RAM in it and she's confused at why there's animals in the in the Xbox. My grandma doesn't know what's going on.
Neither do you, so.
So this is super exciting news. No Man's Sky finally has a release date.
Thank the Lord.
June 21st.
What a sweet game that's going to be.
I'm so excited. So some things I want to talk about. There's a collector's edition of it. It comes. There's a PS4 one that comes with like a steelbook and some prints and stuff like that. I think it's $80.
Yeah.
And then there's a PC one that's $150 that comes with a model ship, which was awesome. And I was this close to buying it. But like, I asked you if you were going to get it on PC because it's PC.
Right.
And I was just going to give you my code and then you could give me the money for it and then I'd have the ship because that's all I wanted. But this game looks awesome.
It looks incredible.
It looks real good.
So I've been looking up stuff. The embargo on this dropped like 2 days ago. And I've been looking at interviews for No Man's Sky.
Yeah.
And I found some interesting things that kind of pertain to VR and No Man's Sky, which has been one of our predictions. We got to get our predictions down and just put them in front of us. So I
we'll find them one day.
One of our predictions was that PlayStation VR was going to come out, whatever price, and it was going to come with No Man's Sky.
Yeah.
It has to be a VR game. And I saw two separate interviews that made it seem highly likely that it was a VR game. The first one I saw was on Kinda Funny. They interviewed the head of the game, the game director, and they're like, hey, is this going to be PlayStation VR compatible? Because it would be a perfect fit.
For sure.
And his response was, I'm not sure how much I'm supposed to say about this, and I'm probably going to say more than I'm supposed to, but we're currently not working on PlayStation VR. Or no, he didn't say that. He said we're a small team and we wouldn't be able to get, you know, he was kind of dancing, but the first thing out of his mouth was, I'm probably going to reveal too much. I think that was the exact quote.
Right. And that's what they usually say.
It's probably always a lot.
Well, the thing is, he's not like a PR person that's through the game. Their studio's like 11 people.
Oh,
and
wow.
Just one of the people working there. It's bigger than that now because once the game got heat, they started getting more people.
Right.
But it's not a big studio, you know. And so he's just getting interviewed. He's super bashful and everything. And he's just well, I'm not supposed to review. And he said that. And I was like, this game's a PlayStation VR game.
Yeah.
And then this was something that was pointed out to me. There was an IGN video that went up in January where it was like the releases of all the games.
Right.
And they got to June and they said No Man's Sky June 21st. And I was like, oh, they gave away the date like months ago and nobody
caught on to it.
Nobody said anything. That must mean they know something because it was correct. And the next words out of their mouth was, that's a PlayStation VR game. And then you see everybody's face, the other three people there kind of freeze and go, hasn't been announced as that. And then he goes, no, I thought it was. And they're like, nope, it's a rumor. Like, they clearly were dancing around that he said that.
That's
so I am confident that March 15th, when we get our PlayStation VR event, we see No Man's Sky PlayStation VR. I don't know if it'll be bundled. it's a it's a VR game, and I think that'd it's going to come out the same day as PlayStation VR.
I mean, that'd be really cool. Well.
That'd be, yeah, that'd be sick.
I think Oculus Oculus comes out. It may be this month, and then April, something like that. Okay. It comes out really soon. Vive comes out real soon, so it makes sense that if PlayStation wants to do this, they announce their date this month, and it comes out in June.
Like, yeah.
Yeah, very, they gotta get on it.
Very small, especially if they're, because if they plan to put it out in the fall, like the GameStop CEO kind of inferred, they're going to be going up against Nintendo's new console, it seems like.
Right.
They're going to be going up against Nintendo's new console, which would be not good, probably. I mean, it can only hurt them.
Right.
So, interesting. So the next piece of news is a bunch of news, and it's the Nintendo Direct. So we watched it, and we're going to do a recap of the Nintendo Direct, just kind of go over announcements. We'll skip ones that we don't care about, which there were a lot.
There were.
And just talk about kind of our favorite things. Okay, so I have some of the announcements pulled up on my computer here, and I'll just skim through them and talk about ones that mattered. So the first thing was we saw more of Star Fox. How do we feel about that?
I mean, I personally love Star Fox, but there's been some questionable Star Fox games.
That's a good way to put it.
Some questionable ones. I think this one looks sweet, as long as they fix like the kind of like steering your ship targeting system they had.
Yeah, like, that it we doesn't saw seem like previously. It's going away, because they talked about having a multiplayer where one person controls the ship and the other person aims.
Right, right.
Which sounds fun for exactly 50% of the party.
For sure. I mean, that's actually a cool feature I think that they added, though.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's fine.
Like a different kind
they of added a one-on-one in Splatoon, and it was awful.
Yeah.
So I'm expecting it to be like that.
Yeah, that's fair. So hopefully that'll like be cool. The mini game though looks
It comes with Star Fox Guard.
Yeah,
I believe it's called.
Yeah,
it's it looks like Five Nights at Freddy's. It's just a bunch of camera
really
security cameras. It's a
it's a kind of like a tower defense.
Yeah, like I was gonna say Plantster versus Zombies.
Yeah, it's it looks real poor.
Comes with the game.
It does. It's
free with the game.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not gonna play. I mean, I'm not gonna get Star Fox. You?
I may get it.
You may get. You're still teetering.
I'm not sure.
I haven't gotten a Wii U yet, but.
I got
maybe
one.
In the near future.
To play a fighting game.
Yes.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that in a minute. So Splatoon's getting more updates. Nothing really notable. They're mostly wanting people to experiment with different weapons. It seems like people aren't changing. I've never used a different weapon since like the third day of having the game.
We tried it. It didn't go well.
Right. Yeah. And then the perks in the game, they're going to make some of them stronger that are a little
just
bit
just trying to balance out the game a little bit.
Yeah.
Which is nice. I like
That's cool. And they also weren't specific. They were like, there's new changes coming to Splatfest, so that doesn't help anything. They revealed a new Mario and Olympic games and Sonic.
That looks really mediocre.
Looks like a game.
Yeah.
Those games have to sell because
I've never seen a rugby video game, so we might have something here, guys.
We're about to.
Super Mario Maker got a bunch of new content, which I'm actually really excited about.
Yeah, it's cool.
Mainly because they made it so you can have mandatory boss battles. They put in keys in the game, so you could make more like mazes.
And not only did they put in keys, but there's like alternate ways to get the keys, which I thought was cool.
Right, you can do the red coins, which reminds me of Mario 64, which is a game
favorite
which is near and dear to my heart. So you can, I fully expect there to be plenty of Mario 64 remake levels with
I could see that for sure.
So that's exciting. what's the name of this dumb game? Tokyo, what is it? Something. Oh, Mirage Seasons. What'd they say?
Sharp.
Yeah, Sharp.
Like the note.
Fire Emblem or FE.
Yeah.
So this is the Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem game. We finally have a name. It's something.
Real confused by the name.
Yeah, the name's dumb.
But the game
looks awesome.
It does look.
I'm
it does
getting
look very
it. Looks
cool.
Like a Persona game.
It sold me. It looks like Persona. I don't know what the Fire Emblem is in it.
It's just the characters.
Are they Fire Emblem characters, or is it they just have that look?
They had that look. There was like one that I recognized. That was it.
Seven. Oh, okay.
Yeah. So if you see the trailer, it's the gameplay trailer. It's Persona. It's 100% Persona, and I am so
which I'm
excited.
Fine with it. I mean, it looks good. It looks like a good
more
game.
Persona.
Yeah.
Not a bad thing.
It also takes place with pop stars on the stage, and there's commercials, which reminds me of Whacked.
That part was questionable.
No,
I think the whole game takes place on a stage.
Yeah. That's how they
describe it. I'm down with that.
It's fine, I guess.
Well, not the commercials.
They talked about some free-to-play game that looked awful. The Lost... We don't need to talk about that. What else do we have? Oh, there's a new Paper Mario game coming out that has to do with painting.
Painting
stuff. You get to paint things.
I mean, that looks interesting.
When they announced it, I was like, cool. And then I watched the trailer, and I was like, not getting it.
Yeah. I mean, it doesn't look cool enough. It looks fine.
Yeah. They talked more about the Pokken tournament, but they didn't actually say... They just kind of went into depth about some of the characters.
Showed a lot more like gameplay of it, which was cool.
Yeah.
Different movesets and stuff.
Still don't understand that game. Like, this trailer made me excited for it.
Yeah.
I'm 100% down for playing it, and now borderline buying it. But I'm still confused at the camera in the game. Why is it sometimes behind them and sometimes it looks like a good fighting game?
So I think how it works is like when you're just doing like your, like, you know, your punch, kick, and stuff, you're looking from like kind of like that side behind view. But when you start like a combo, it kind of switches views and you get to see the full combo.
But they showed like Pikachu fighting something, and it was side the whole time. And the only time in the trailer that it was that behind the back view was like the match started and went until he hit him, and when it hit him the camera turned. So I don't know, have you seen, they had a tournament or something that I haven't watched.
The tournament was weird too. Like,
Keep changing?
Mm-hmm. It kept changing.
Yeah, it's so like a dynamic camera. So it just changes.
I don't know if you can change it at will or if it changes on its own.
I don't like that.
Yeah, it's weird.
It looks good, though.
Yeah, the game looks awesome.
It does look really
cool. It's selling me. They showed off some new free-to-play amiibo games that nobody's going to play. Super Nintendo games are exclusively coming to the new 3DS, which is cool.
That's fun. I'm always fine with that. That's cool.
There's some game with cards and horses.
Oh, that game looked awesome. What's it called? It's called the
Pocket Card Jockey.
Yeah.
It looks awful. It's solitaire in a horse racing game.
What's the problem?
And you can upgrade your horses and breed them.
You put rockets on them and stuff?
No, it looks awful.
It looks real bad, guys. If you like solitaire...
Don't buy this game. Play something else.
Get on your computer and play it.
Azure Striker Gunvolt 2 was announced. I'm super excited about this. I really liked the first one.
It looks like awesome. A good Mega Man.
It's done by Indie Creates, who did a bunch of Mega Man marks.
Yeah, it looks really cool.
And they announced a new character, and you can kill the 7 bosses, and you get their powers when you beat them.
Yeah, it's very
super
cool.
Excited.
A good Mega Man.
They talked about the Hyrule Warriors for the 3DS, which I'm still surprised is happening. Because
Hyrule Warriors Legends, right?
Yeah. I'm still surprised that that's happening because I don't believe that the 3DS can run that game.
We're going to find out.
I don't believe it.
Very obviously can. They made it.
I mean, I know the Japanese one has huge frame rate issues.
Really?
Yeah, that's why I don't understand why they're putting like full support. Like, it looks like they're having a whole new season of DLC in addition to the season that they already had.
Yeah.
So it's got to be doing well. I mean, their DLC is awesome, and it's well priced. The prices are great as far as you get a lot of content.
I mean, as far as the Dynasty Warriors games go, and I've played a lot of them, like Gundam ones being some of my favorite.
Yeah, this was my first one.
This one was really well done. Like, it's good. Really cool. The way they did the characters was like really sweet too.
They talked about Bravely Second some more, which I'm interested in.
Yep.
They got me interested in a lot of things actually. They had some Monster Hunters. But the big one, Metroid Federation Force.
Oh, man.
So you guys both didn't see the original announcement of this game where they just announced it as Federation Force
and
played a bunch of soccer.
I don't see the problem with
that. And as soon as it went up, I'm like, this kind of looks like bad Metroid.
Yeah.
And then the next day they announced, they're like, it's Metroid Federation Force. And this was... real depressing. So when they announced, or not announced, but when they did this direct, they almost felt like they were apologizing for the game and trying to prove to you why it belonged in the Metroid timeline or universe. And I don't know. I haven't looked at the likes and dislikes of the
I mean, I think the big thing people disliked about it is like having a Metroid game without having Samus, you know?
I think that's a big thing, like, and I also think that people would have preferred if this was a brand new IP, like it was announced as Federation Force,
right,
and they didn't just put Metroid on it to
didn't
sell
just
it.
Slap Metroid in front of it.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm fine with it being like, there's more to the Metroid world than Samus. You know what I'm saying? And I think people need to understand.
Yeah, we don't know it.
Yeah, that's fair.
And this doesn't look interesting enough to me. to be part of it. Like, it's so far removed from what Metroid is.
Yeah, that's very fair. I mean, at least they give, like, kind of a storyline. I know they'll just throw you into this, like, weird game and call it Metroid.
Yeah, this is the first time where they've actually shown enough of the game that I feel like people can make an opinion on it, as opposed to before where it was, like, knee-jerk reactions of people just hating it.
Yeah. I mean, the multiplayer looks questionable. I think it looks fun.
Yeah, both of you guys were watching it, and you're like, why is everybody complaining?
Yeah, I think the campaign looks really cool. It just looks like some kind of sweet monster hunting game.
Yeah.
And my dude looks like Metroid, you know?
You're just a different color Metroid.
Yeah.
And then the big, I guess big announcement, it wasn't really a big announcement, the final announcement was that we got a new Kirby game with a bunch of robots. You can get a Kirby bot.
Yeah, it's really cool. So Kirby just has a giant robot, and he sucks things in, and his robot turns into another robot.
He just tears up stuff in the robot.
So I've always been, like, you know, on the fence about Kirby. Some games have been really sweet. Some games have been
not
weird.
A big fan of Kirby.
But this one actually looks really cool, and I'm interested to play it a lot.
I like Kirby and Smash.
Yeah.
Kirby's if you scan in the Smash amiibo, you get his moveset, which is kind of cool.
That was cool.
Yeah, I liked it.
The amiibos,
not only that, you can scan in other amiibos as well.
Yeah, I was just about to say, the amiibos to me are crossing the, like, cool little quirks additional thing. Yeah. Like, they're becoming DLC. Adding way too, like, Splatoon, you unlock a whole new campaign. You can unlock three new campaigns.
I think that's cool. Yeah.
Really? You think that's cool? See, I don't think that's cool because the only way to get them is through the amiibos, which were impossible to get.
Oh, that's fair.
They're not.
If they made the amiibos a little more accessible, like, I think the amiibos are cool. You know, they're cool statues. Everybody likes cool statues. I don't like the amiibo card thing system they're bringing on. I think it's really silly.
I think it would be cool if they were real, like, cards that you could play in real life and also scan them.
Oh, if they made, like, a
game
out of it, kind of?
I think that would be awesome, where all the cards, so, like, you can have the Animal Crossing set and the Pokemon set and whatever.
That would be
and
cool.
That game, the live card game works. You can mix and match everything.
Right.
But games you could scan in the cards as well.
I mean, it's not the cheapest thing to make, like, you know, like a statue. You have to get, like, someone to mold it and stuff like that.
No, so I'm not saying
I
that.
See why they went to the cards, but I think the cards are really silly. Like,
yeah, they talked about cards when they were talking about amiibos just to make it more accessible for, like,
cheaper.
If you wanted a pit, you could get
just
a
easier
pit.
To do,
it's just cheaper. Like, I don't understand why they have such, like, a limited quantity on these amiibos. It's crazy.
They don't really anymore. Now you can basically get what you want. There's only a couple of them that, like, the gold Mario is hard to get.
Yeah.
Can't find a gold Mega Man. Anybody gonna miss that boat? And now I can't get one.
Yeah.
You're not missing much.
You're missing an amiibo boat.
I went
to
GameStop today, and I asked them if they had it, and they were like, we got in three.
Jeez.
I was like, okay.
Still crazy. Nobody likes Mega Man.
That's not what they said. They were like, they were all pre-ordered, and they all got picked up the day it came out.
Yeah,
that's actually what he said.
Yeah, I believe it.
So I do want the gold Mega Man now, just because apparently that's going to be a hard one to get. Who knew?
You should have got it.
Yeah, I'll try and find. I don't want to pay more than I had it for $40, and I didn't buy it, and now it's like $70.
Good job.
It's miserable.
Messed up on that one.
Yeah. Well. All right. So let's move into a question here. So what is the first video game we've played, and what games made us into gamers? It's basically the question. I'll go first. A little game called Mega Man 3. my favorite game of all time. The best game of all time. So my early memories with this game are just my brother. He was able to play through the game and beat it, and I was like, that's amazing, because it's such a difficult game. And then I would play, and I wouldn't be very good, and I wouldn't be very good. And while he was gone doing whatever, he was older, so he was going to school and work and stuff.
Right.
I would practice the game.
Yeah.
So whenever he would come back, I'd be like, look, I can beat this level and this level all by myself now.
Yeah.
And it just went until I was able to beat the game. And that was really when it started. And then every year for Christmas, I specifically remember I would get one Mega Man game every year for however many years, until I had 1 through 6, and then the PlayStation came out, and I got X4, and then I got X5, and then I got X6, and there's numerous pictures of me, just that my mom took or whatever, of me standing by the TV with, like, all the Robot Masters beaten, smiling.
That's
I was
awesome.
Like, ah, this is great. This topic actually reminded me of my niece, who I was recently talking to, and she's a big gamer. She plays a lot of Call of Duty, but she's always on PlayStation.
Yeah.
And I was talking to her in the party chat, and I was like, what was the first game you played?
Yeah.
Like, I was just kind of curious. And she was like, Animal Crossing? I think it was Animal Crossing.
That's a weird one to start
with. And I was like, huh, well, not really. And then I was thinking about it. I was like, yeah, I gave her my GameCube because she liked that game so much. Like, I totally forgot about that. Yeah. I gave her my GameCube for her birthday 1 year. And she's like, yeah, I used to watch you play RuneScape, of all things. she's like, you would play that for hours, and I would just sit behind you, and we'd talk about the game. And then I made my own account on there, yeah. And then I played. And she's like, that really started it, and now she plays all the time. And I was like, oh, that's cool.
That's cool.
Yeah. So what are some of your first games or gaming memories? So
the first game that I really remember playing a lot is Duck Hunt.
It's a good one.
I mean, it's sweet, yeah. It's just like, it's kind of a funny one to start on,
I mean, it came with the NES, so
yeah,
it's a
valid
game.
So
that's a pretty good starting point, I guess.
Yeah, I played that a lot. That's like the only game, like my brother had all kind of games for the NES, but like that's the one I played a lot for some reason. I think I just like the gun a lot.
You actually just like shooting and clicking.
Like, what like really got me into gaming was like, I guess Baldur's Gate was like the first game. Just because there's like this sweet like open world and this like cool storyline and stuff going on. And then like I started following like the BioWare games as they came out, and like a lot of those games like Jade Empire.
Yeah, you talk about Jade
Knights
Empire
of the Old Republic. Like these games really got me involved in the gaming. And I just like I kind of grew from there, you know, really getting into the RPGs.
Mm-hmm.
What do about like you? BioWare.
That's BioWare is sweet.
We're going to play Jade Empire soon.
Oh, I'm excited, man.
As soon as we finish another game. What about you, Kellen?
I have to go back to, I had an Atari 2600 and playing way back. Like, oh yeah, like Tecmo Bowl and
Pong.
That kind of stuff. Yeah. And we had the little handheld two-player Tecmo Bowl. I think it was Tecmo Bowl. I don't remember. It's a little football game. Me and my dad used to play.
Yeah.
And that was awesome. That's pretty much where I started.
I have an Atari 2600 in my closet now. I remember getting that. I bought it off eBay. Because I was like, this is like the first video game console. I have to have this. Because, I know, but I'm being little kid Kevin.
Right.
This is the first video game console. I have to have this in my collection, blah, 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 blah. So I get it, and I get like Pac-Man for it. And I get Pong. I get Asteroids. And then I hook it up, and I'm like, these aren't fun.
Yeah.
I was like, these are real dated. And
they were when that's all you had.
No, they were. Sure. And there's some good, like Pitfall's still awesome. There's a couple that are still
Asteroid's
awesome.
Asteroid's actually fun. It's like, it's a fun game.
That's still fun.
Yeah, that game's still fun.
But there's better versions of every single one of those games.
Oh, for sure. Which is, you know, that's awesome. You know, it's cool. Yeah, it's cool.
It was just funny.
It's cool to play those games and like see how much, like, even like, you know, spin off. Of those games have like evolved like so much over the years.
That's something that I always think about. Like if you have a kid or, you know, son, daughter, whatever, and they want to get into gaming,
right?
Do you give them an Atari 2600?
Yeah.
And you're like, do you go? And then after a while, you're like, here's an NES.
Yeah.
And then after, or do you say, here's a PS6 or whatever we're on at that time? That'd be real far away.
PC, go nuts.
No.
Yeah, like
I think it's cool to have.
What order
like,
do you do that?
To start a kid on like something like that, you know,
that's what I would
something
like
simple,
something
yeah.
like Duck Hunt, you know, and it gives them the appreciation of like video games.
Yeah.
I have a little cousin. I think he's like 12 now, and he started off playing Call of Duty with me, like at my house. So I don't think that was good. Like he literally only plays shooter games now, and he's really good at them. But that's all he does, and he like doesn't appreciate anything else.
Just start him on Pokemon.
You know, that's fine. That's another
one
that really got me into games. Is Pokemon.
Yeah.
Like, that's one of the first games where I finished like the whole storyline and had like a blast with it. That's the first game that I was like on the bus, you know, and I was like, can't wait to get home and play Pokemon.
Why don't you just take it on the bus with you?
You can.
You get in trouble for that. Yeah. Why is it that everybody loves Pokemon? I didn't like Pokemon growing up. It's so weird. Like, I liked them. I liked the card game. I liked the show. But the actual game, I was like, what is this? And my sister was the one that actually played it.
Yeah, I think the show, like, really got
me into
it.
She's a big gamer now.
The game was just so much fun, though. Like,
I'm sure if she were to answer, she would cite Pokemon as one of the
ones. And it's so, like, simplistic to play. Like, it's cool. And it's so sweet because you could, like, you know, you could show up to a friend's house and be like, hey, you want to trade or, like, battle with me, you know?
That's true.
That was, like, so much fun. It's like we were on the show, you know, battling. So.
I should catch him.
Yeah.
You got to wear your hat backwards, though.
Oh, I mean, you wear it forward then.
I mean,
backwards.
I liked I had a Pokedex.
Yeah.
I had a Pokeball.
Oh, everyone had a Pokedex.
I had a hat, Ash's hat. I had a vest.
Just a random vest.
Just didn't like the video games.
Yeah,
didn't
the
like
video
the best
games
part
were
of Pokemon.
Were awful. You know that thing that they came from? Didn't like it.
It's even cool to see like something like that evolve too, like into Pokken. Like, would have never like thought about
Pokemon Snap.
Yeah.
Why didn't they make that for the Wii U?
I don't know. That would have been sweet.
That's a good question.
That would have been sweet.
That fits so perfectly. Why didn't they do that?
That's a good question.
Nintendo messing everything up. All right, so now I want to talk about GameStop. I have a couple things to say about this.
Your favorite store.
Yeah, no, see, I'm not one of those people that, like, hates GameStop. I advise people, I'm like, you can find it cheaper. Don't sell your stuff to GameStop, et cetera, et cetera. It's just, it's in the name GameStop, and people use it because of that. And there's a million of them, so they're super accessible.
They're easier to find, and they're super accessible.
So recently, I've gotten real mad at them, and I don't know if you guys have any, but I just wanted to hear some GameStop stories. It can be pro GameStop, it can be against GameStop, but I just want to talk about them kind of as a whole, and not if they're good or bad for the industry, but we can do anything from how long are they going to be around, because they're going to be hurting soon. They're publishing games now, so they're clearly, they partnered with ThinkGeek. Like,
right.
They're worried about their future. They're trying to future-proof themselves. And we can listen to my lovely story about how mad I am. So we want to start with the story, or do we want to start with GameStop?
Let's just talk about GameStop as a whole, and then we'll talk about Kevin's sad story.
Kevin's sad. That's most of the stories.
It's actually happy right now, but we're going
to
see.
So, I mean, I've always gone to GameStop, like, since I started, like, hardcore gaming. I recently started, you know, doing more online stuff. But, like, I, you know, I've enjoyed, like, the GameStop exclusives. The customer service is usually, like, fine. Like, obviously, there's cases where it's not so great.
People
usually,
that work there like games.
Yeah, which
is nice.
Cool. They don't just hire anyone.
People that work at Toys R Us don't like toys.
Yeah, they're just
some
working there
do.
For a job.
Some people don't.
Yeah. Which is, like, that's cool to, like, have, like, an atmosphere like that. Like, I can bring up any game, and they can start telling about the game, what it's about, you know. It's really cool to get that, like, a personal experience at GameStop.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that was where I got my Wii U, and that guy knew everything I was asking about.
Yeah, and, like, most of the time, obviously, stuff's not going to be discounted, and they're going to try to make money off you and stuff like that.
I mean, they're a business.
But they're a business, you know what I'm saying?
Like, yeah, and my argument to that is always just, if you don't like them, don't shop there.
Yeah.
Tell your friends not to shop. Like,
right.
Don't go there, because the only reason they're in business is because they're getting business.
Because people
you know?
If they're, they're not there to be your friend. You know what I'm saying? And that's, like, a problem I've heard with people. They're like, well, I can just go online. I'm like, cool, man. They
do
don't,
it.
They
well
don't
then,
really care.
Well, then go online,
Lots of just GameStop hate and everything. So do we, how long do we think GameStop's going to last? Do we think that the physical games are going to be there in the PS5, Xbox 2? The Xbox 2.
So I think there's going to be a big console that's going to try not to make, like, the hard disk games.
No disk drive.
Yeah. And I think it's going to fail.
The PSP Go did it.
Yeah.
That worked well.
How'd that go?
Exactly.
How'd that
like,
go?
I don't think it's going to work. And we're going to see who does it first. And I don't think it's going to be Microsoft.
I think it will be Microsoft.
I don't think you can get rid of the drive, but I think somebody will try.
Yeah, someone's going to try. But
the rumors are the NX doesn't have a disk drive.
Right.
I probably won't buy an NX.
Yeah,
if
that's
it doesn't have.
I mean, it's gonna be a flop. There's been many a console flop, and that'll be one.
The Wii U.
Yeah.
I like my Wii.
The Wii's actually picking up popularity.
The N64.
Just like systems. But anyways, back onto the like the GameStop being around. Like, you can see they, you know, they exchange gift cards and stuff like that.
Oh yeah, I forgot about
that.
They're
sponsoring like other game companies. You know, they're producing games now.
They look like a toy store when you walk in.
Yeah,
it's like clustered.
Yeah,
you're like sliding past all the Funko Pops
and I think
the statues.
Like a, I think like a, I was gonna say, I think a big thing for them now is like the Skylander statues and Meebos and stuff like that.
Well, yeah, because
like,
people will buy those anywhere because you
can't
buy them.
Right.
Not the easiest thing to find.
Right, or like trading in consoles and getting, you know, used ones and stuff like that. Like, it's just like, it's almost not a game store anymore.
You can buy phones there.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Tablets.
Like, we've seen other companies do this too, but like GameStop doing it's kind of sad. Like, that's like, you know.
They're buying retro games now and selling retro games on their website.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised if we start seeing GameStop's have like game renting centers where you can like rent an area and play games and stuff like that.
I can see
like
a
lot
like
of
a
retro
kind of thing.
Well, that, but I mean, oh, I didn't even think about that.
Yeah, Blockbuster tried to do that when they started going out of business. They tried to make.
Yeah, I mean, there was a Blockbuster.
It was actually it was a good try. Like,
I didn't even think about GameStop trying to do turn into a rental service.
They talked about it. They talked about making like
you
a Redbox
game Redbox outside the door when they're not open.
Or they talked they talked about collaborating with Redbox as well, because Redbox you know has like you have to wait 20 they have to wait 28 days to get licensing on a game or something like to put it in the Redbox. So that's kind of crazy, you know. No one wants to rent a game after.
Man, I never even you just blew my mind. That's a good thing. And now they're going to be publishing games. They're publishing Insomniac's new game, and they're going to have the exclusive like physical copy of the, if you want that game physically, but they have to go to GameStop.
Decreased sales in the past 2 years with like much digital marketing going on.
Yeah, digital sales are going to be 50% of the industry in the next year or two here, which is unbelievable to me. It's also not that unbelievable because there's also just more games. Like Firewatch, digital only. I bought that. Unraveled, digital only. I bought that. Yeah. Like there's all these digital only games.
I've only
been
buying digital only on my Xbox, but my disk drive broke. So I'm just getting forced
into
it.
So you actually have this Xbox future that we're talking about. How is it, Todd?
Well, it's miserable, let me tell you.
Yeah, if a game comes out physically the same day as digitally, I 100% buy it physical, always.
It's so nice buying it physical. First of all, like it feels rewarding, like going into a store and like just picking up the copy,
opening it up.
Plus, I can bring it here.
Yeah. And I love like collector's editions of things. Having like statues or like sweet hardcovers. Yeah, it's so cool. And like not everybody's into that. So I mean, the digital is very nice. You know, I can just be, you know, a fat fuck and sit around my house and buy games and play them, which I do right now. But
the other problem is my internet here is just awful. Like, I downloaded the Uncharted 4 beta on Tuesday or whenever it went live. Right. I think it finished on like Thursday and then I could play it Friday. So that was sweet.
I mean, one cool thing about the digital market, like, that they added now is like all these like exclusive games now. Like, which is cool. You know, they're just digital only, which is
Yeah, it allows indie developers. That's what I'm saying about that digital statistic. I think that's so skewed because guess what? I probably buy more digital games than physical games. I still prefer the physical games. If those games came out physically, I would have bought them. We're going to talk about a game.
Every free game that you get counts as a purchase, like on any market.
Oh, that's true too. Yeah,
it's just a free purchase. That's so true. So but obviously those
we're
going
to talk about a game a little later that I've been waiting over a year for to come out physically, and guess what? They're re-releasing it digitally.
Yeah.
Still not buying it. Yeah. Put it out physically and I will buy your game. Or if your game's really good and I'm like compelled, like Shovel Knight.
Yeah.
I have a physical copy of Shovel Knight downstairs. Yeah. I bought it digitally the game like the day it came out.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna do it with Mega Man Legacy Collection
for sure.
as well. Pick that up when I
but like we've kind of gone off the GameStop topic a little bit.
Nope. I'm just getting angry because I want physical games.
He just wants hard copies.
But all in all, you know, I've had like a couple arguments with GameStop before about little things, nothing crazy. But I've gone in there and bought nothing and just had conversations about stuff with them, which is cool. You know, they're not like, you know, buy something or leave. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like
I wouldn't have my Pit Amiibo if it weren't for GameStop. I went in there. I was like, hey, I want the Pit Amiibo.
Yeah.
Do you have it? And they're like, no, nobody has it. I got one because I pre-ordered it, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And he's like, and he goes on the computer and he's like, there might be one for you.
Yeah.
And he called the other store and he's like, do you have Pit? And they're like, yeah. And he's like, is it a pre-order? Can this guy come get it? Can you hold it for him? And he's like, it's a pre-order, but it goes out in 2 days.
Oh, okay.
It runs out if he doesn't pick it up. And they're like, well, can we put his name down and his phone number? And she's like, yeah, sure. And then they called me 2 days later and they're like, hey, nobody picked up this Pit. Do you want it? And I was there within 20 minutes.
Yeah, that's
we went to a lot of stores looking for the Pit.
That was a long
day. Yeah.
Yeah, I went in to get a to pre-order Destiny, but they give you like a poster, and then when it came out, you got like some kind of collectible statue, which I don't think they ever came out with.
Is it the ghost?
Yeah,
that came out.
Did they? Okay. Anyways,
it talks.
Okay. But I just wanted the poster. It's like a flip poster. It's really cool. But they ran out of them. I pre-ordered like online or something. I went to pick up my poster. They're like, we're out of them. And I was like, oh man.
That kind of thing. And the guy was like, yeah, man. You know, you can have mine.
Oh, that's really nice.
Yeah, it's really cool.
I mean, he gets all the free stuff from the store.
Yeah.
I have a poster right there. Catherine, one of my favorite games. My friend working at GameStop got that because she knew
they get them all the time.
Yeah. You know, you can get movie theater posters or if you work in a movie theater.
So on to Kevin's...
So I have
rant
two...
GameStop.
Yeah, it's not really a rant. I have two GameStop stories that we can talk about.
Yeah.
Okay, so my first GameStop story is just a simple one that I just think is funny. It has to do with my dad going in the GameStop. So basically, I went to GameStop. I was way younger during this, and I bought a controller, like, way younger. I bought a controller because the price on the controller was wrong. So they had multiple... We'll say it's a PS2 controller. I have no clue what it was. We'll say they were $15, and they had one for, like, $8. It was just the wrong price. So naturally, I grabbed that one, and I asked for it, and we bought it. This was with my mom. I went and did this. So then I got home. Controller didn't work. So however many days later, I went back with my dad to return the controller, and we tried to return it and swap it for another one.
Yeah.
And the lady's like, you have to pay more for the controller because this was the wrong price. And he's like, that doesn't make any sense. We paid this price. This item doesn't work. We should get a new one, you know? And she's like, no, it was marked wrong. You're going to have to pay more.
Yeah, that's kind of crazy.
For the,
it's not your fault.
For the, I know. And it, that's basically what he's saying. He's like, it's not our fault. You guys put the wrong, like, if somebody puts the wrong price on something and somebody else buys it, like, yeah, that's on you. It's right, not on them for looking for a cheaper price or whatever.
Right.
So they get into a bit, like, they're, like, borderline screaming at each other over this stupid controller. I'm sitting on the floor, little Kevin.
Over, like, $8.
Flipping through a magazine. Yeah, she starts going, you know what? I'm the, he goes, can I speak to the manager? And she does, I am the manager. And she's like, you know what? I'll pay for this out of my own paycheck. Is that what you want? And all this stuff. I'm just sitting on the floor laughing, like, I don't know what's going on. And he just storms out with the controller that we paid for, like, a while back.
Yeah.
But she's trying to get us to pay more.
Yeah.
And she looks at me and she's like, should I call the cops? And I'm just like, I don't know what's going on.
That's crazy.
It was ridiculous. So I think in the end, I didn't get a new controller, and I have a broken PS2 controller somewhere that my dad almost got the cops called him on him over for making the store lady
mad. I'm sure GameStop didn't call the cops a lot.
Oh, no. I mean, they didn't do it, obviously.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, but it was just kind of funny. It's just something I remember.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Like, hilarious.
I could see that happening.
And so, to my actual story, this happened to me 2 days ago. So, GameStop currently has a deal on DS games. Buy two, get one free.
It's a sweet deal.
It is a sweet deal, and their DS game prices are good.
Yeah.
They're actually very good pre-owned games.
Right.
They're good prices. So, I was like, you know, I have a 3DS, which plays DS games.
Yeah.
And I don't have any games for it. I don't own a DS game. I've never played a DS game. I want to buy some DS games. So I was like, what do I want? Mega Man games. There's a bunch of Mega Man DS games. So I look and they have like 11 of them or something. And I was like, okay.
You bought all of them?
I'll buy all of them. So I add them all to my cart. And I look at the total and it's like $100 whatever. And I'm like, that's not right. Because if you do buy two, get one free, every third most expensive one should be cheap.
Right.
So if I buy three $15 games, the $15 game should be free.
Right.
If I buy three $10 games, the $10 games. It didn't do it that way. GameStop does it, just the three cheapest were free. So it was three $5 games that were free in my total order. And I'm like, this is BS. I should be getting like $50 saved right now, and they're saving me $15. Like, this is ridiculous.
Split it up in different transactions.
So I was like, I'm going to split it up in different transactions.
Yeah.
Except then you have to pay handling on every single one and shipping on every single one. I'm like, this is ridiculous. So I was like, I'll do free shipping. But then you need to have an order of over $25 and you can't get them into the cart without it doing the subtract the minus the lowest cost ones again. And I was like, this is getting ridiculous. So I just emailed them. Also, the other issue I have with this is I want the case. Now, this is just a personal thing, you know. I want the case for the game and the manual. I don't care so much about the manual. I want the case. So I go to the actual physical store. I'm like, do you guys have the DS cases? Because your selection here is just the games. Like, are they in the back and you go get them when you purchase it? He's like, no, we just have the games. I'm like, oh, okay. So I look online with some employees talking on, like, Reddit and such. And they're like, yeah, the employees just take the cases or they throw them out.
Yeah.
So I was like, really?
Save room.
So then I went into some trading websites and stuff, and there's GameStop employees that just have hundreds of cases, DS cases that they're selling. Yeah. And I'm like, this is ridiculous. So it wouldn't, I honestly, there were good prices and everything, and I would buy them if they had the cases for the games that I want. Like, that's fine. But they didn't. So I just emailed them, GameStop, and I was like, hey, look, I want the cases. Is there any way I can get them? I'm looking to buy like 12 games here.
Yeah.
If not, like, what are my odds of getting them? You know, I was just asking them. That was 4 days ago. They still haven't answered me. So I was like, okay, well, I'm just going to buy the three $15 games.
Yeah.
Get my free shipping, pay my $4 handling or whatever it is, and then have them sent to me.
Yeah.
And one of them came the next day. So I looked at the tracking. I'm like, well, this one's not going to have a case. It's just in an envelope.
Yeah.
And it showed up the next day in an envelope. And
what a beating.
The interesting thing was it showed up by itself because they ship them in different from different facilities. So the receipt for that one was just $0.00 game.
That was a free one?
Yeah. And I'm like, that's a little weird.
That is very weird.
So then the next case comes a few days later, and I have one with the case. And I'm like, oh, so it does. There are some. I don't know because the GameStop lady in customer service didn't answer me.
It's weird
me.
That it doesn't tell you that like online when you're buying the game.
With that's or without really strange.
It does say that.
Oh, okay.
No, yeah, I was just asking for exceptions and or what's the odds that I would get it type thing.
Yeah.
So I got one with the case and everything. And I'm like, oh, that's cool. I put it on my shelf. And then I got the other one that didn't have the case. So I went to GameStop today and returned that one.
Yeah.
But since they came in separate transactions, the free one wasn't on the list of the other one. So I just returned that for my cashback, and I have the other game.
Oh, that's insane.
So I was like, that's cool.
Yeah.
So what I did was I've done three separate orders through GameStop now.
Yeah.
All for different ones with free games. And I'm just going to return all the ones that don't have cases and then buy again until I get the ones with cases. That's my solution to this problem, because they just give you your money back in the store, which is really nice.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's my GameStop story. That's what I'm going through right now.
Yeah.
So I just want the
there's
cases.
There's some GameStop around here that's going to have a bunch of Mega Man DS games.
I'm going to different ones every time I return. I returned it today and I was like, hey, my brother already has this game. And he's like, it's a duplicate game. And I was like, yeah. And he goes, okay. And he returned it or whatever. But yeah, I just don't understand, especially like the shopping cart thing with the buy two, get one free. Like that's
kind of crazy.
That's sneaky, you know, to not be able to pick the game that you want if it's eligible and everything. But anyway,
That's probably just like a web design flaw, though. You know what I'm saying?
That's just an automatic thing in their system.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know, but you should fix that. It's a problem.
That's part of how the website works. Takes the cheapest one off.
Fix it. That's my GameStop story. I know it's not very exciting.
I mean, they are just a company trying to make money.
I'm just
trying to rip some money off, you know.
Got the game. Can't wait to never play it. It's a real bad Mega Man.
Is there a good Mega Man?
Yes. So
just one though.
Mega Man 3.
Oh, it's so good. Let's move on to the game releases. And once again, we have a write-up from the one and only Gareth.
Gareth's all right.
So what games are coming out this coming week?
Well, let's see. March 8th. Blast'em Bunnies.
Of the year.
Wave-based shooter. X-Bone, PS4, Vita, and 3DS.
It's a Vita game.
Odd combination. Yeah, it's a real game. Basically, it's a wave-based shooter. You control a turret. You get attacked by a bunch of cartoons.
Meh.
Bunch of bunnies.
No interest for
you
me.
You don't want to shoot bunnies?
Not really. Right. I think I shot a bunny in The Division.
Nice.
March 8th, The Division.
Okay.
That one, I guess I'll have to buy this game.
You're getting it? We were talking about this earlier.
I think it looks, it looks like a fine game. It looks like they spent some time on it, you know?
Well, yeah, they spent a lot
Tom
of time.
I'm a big
Tom
Clancy fan.
I mean, it's been around for a little while. So.
Yeah. I personally find it a little dull, like, to look at, and just, like, I haven't played it personally yet, but just watching playthroughs of it, it looks kind of, looks a little dull.
Yeah, I love the menus and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. I like how it integrates. It was a little much, though.
Yeah.
When I was playing it, I was like, oh, cool, they have all this integration to make the menus clean, but then they have 15 items popping up on your screen, and your HUD is just, like, ridiculous.
It's just crowded.
It's not something that I'm going to, like, I was talking about, I said, if you surprise me right now and you're like, hey, I have a copy of The Division, I wouldn't play it. I just don't have any interest.
I don't think it's a bad game by any means.
No, yeah, I have no opinion on the game because I literally have no interest in playing it.
Yeah, same.
I'll probably have it Tuesday.
And then you can let us know.
Yeah.
If it's miserable or pretty good or somewhere in between.
Looks fine to me.
Yeah, that's exactly how I feel. It looks fine.
Looks fine. I kind of want a shooter like that, so.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, it'll be pretty on my PC.
That's
fair.
I think the character customization is kind
of
cool.
Yeah, I mean, it does a lot of cool things. I just don't care. Like, the Tom Clancy games, my interest in them recently has been like, the only thing that can, if they reveal a new Splinter Cell at E3 this year, I'm back on board.
All about them Splinter Cell games.
I'm back on
that
board.
When
I mean, they did Rainbow Six, and then they did Ghost Recon last year.
Mm-hmm. That Ghost Recon game is actually
this
really
year,
good.
Splinter Cell. Like, that's the next one, right?
One problem I did have with, like, The Division, like, watching people play it, is, like, I think the combat system's kind of weird for...
It's definitely weird.
Yeah.
It's an RPG.
Yeah.
Point totals.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's an RPG, but it also has that, like, you know, it still has that kind of Tom Clancy game kind of feel, like, where you're, like, trying to get in a cover and things like that.
Yeah.
which I don't think those two like go game together. Concepts go together very well.
That's a good point.
So it makes for kind of like a stealth RPG kind of like playthrough, which is weird.
We'll find out.
And a lot of RPGs, you're like all in people's faces and stuff. So, you know, maybe it's different, but that's a good point. You know, is it a good different?
What maybe. Else we got?
Jump Tanks for the PC. 5v5 anime style multiplayer shooter with some RPG elements. Basically, you get customizable tanks in a fighting arena kind of thing.
Sounds fun. That's one that I feel like I'd have to play.
Unusual. Yeah.
I mean, sounds fun. There's actually all kinds of games like this that come out all the time for PC.
It's one of those little PC.
The problem that I have with it was you said PC. That sounds like a game I want to sit down on the couch with three other people and play split screen and to have a grand old time. And I can't do that with my
PC. I mean, this is a game we'll see on Twitch for a week, and then no one will ever play it again.
Do you think we'll see it on Twitch?
Somebody
in a queue somewhere will boot this up.
Yeah.
Somebody waiting for their actual game
to
start.
Somebody waiting for the leaked queue to pop.
I can't remember the name of the game. You're like a demon, and you just like shoot these red beams out of your arm.
I know what you're talking about. Yeah, yeah.
But it like blew up on Twitch because a guy playing League of Legends was waiting for a queue, and he just started playing this game. And 20,000
people. That's so crazy. That's why they give streamers all these free games.
20,000 people.
Free advertising.
Yeah. And then I go back on Twitch the next day, and this game's like huge.
It's like number 10 game on Twitch or something.
Yeah. It's a fine game, but all you're doing is like shooting at things in the dark.
Yeah.
And you do like levels up, and you just see how long. It's like a survival game.
Yeah. It's like a bullet hell.
But there's games like this all the time. So I think this will be one of those games. Like, it's whatever. But it'll be fun for a week.
Yeah.
It's not going to be like Rocket League or anything.
Yeah, well, that was an anomaly.
That was crazy. And it's still an anomaly.
Yeah, it is.
It's crazy.
It's still fun.
Mm-hmm.
That was your game of the year?
Yeah.
Game's a lot of fun.
PS4 game. Kolyat, I think, maybe. I don't know. Horror exploration game inspired by true events. Apparently something freaky in Russia.
Yeah, it was like it was like a hiking trip gone wrong. Style thing, and they found the bodies, and they couldn't figure out what happened, and they, like, were deducing some of them were murdered, but they couldn't figure out like what happened with this type thing. Yeah, it's interesting. I talked about it last week, I believe, with horror games, you can't see a horror game trailer, you have to play a demo or something of a horror game to understand if it scares you.
You have
to have that tension of I don't want to turn this corner or I don't want to, you know, and. Sometimes, like, you can watch Outlast and be really scared, and then you can play Outlast and you're like, oh, this is telegraphed.
One game that differentiated like from that a little bit for me was like PT.
Watch PT
and it was like really interesting just to watch.
Breaks my heart.
It does.
My little silent heart.
I'm not that worried about PT.
And nobody is anymore.
Exactly.
I'm not like trying to get stuck on that game, but just using that as an example.
That's definitely one. Also, people just like watching people get scared. Myself, I'm an actual huge fan of horror games. Like, I like playing horror games, but I don't like Outlast. I don't like Alien Isolation. Like, I don't like these games that are jump scare, jump scare, jump scare. There's a guy following you.
I get the Alien Isolation one a little bit.
That one's better.
Yeah.
But I just want this buildup of tension and puzzles that horror games have been kind of known for. Mm-hmm. But that's just not where we're going with the direction of horror games. So I'm always cautious about looking
at them. A lot of jump scares now, for sure.
Yeah, it's just all... Because it's the streamers.
Yeah, the storylines.
They want to get streamers going, ah.
The storylines have all been like fine, though, for recent ones. Like, I thought Alien Isolation
Horror game storylines were always really weird. Like, they normally just didn't make any sense.
Yeah,
or you think about something like Resident Evil. It's like Umbrella Corp. And then
fire.
Like, then they just go off. Yeah.
Yeah. So. But the gameplay is fun.
So. Yeah.
And this one, it's like a little different. Like, it's almost like a movie. You're like playing through a movie, and you're just getting jump scared. Like,
that's fair.
The past, like the modern horror
That's what movies are now too. Horror movies used to be way more like tension based, and then now you look at something like, even if you look at Paranormal Activity 1, which was awesome, like tension and everything.
Yeah.
With there was really minimal jump scares in that, and then you look at like 4, which is every 3 minutes. It's like,
that's crazy.
Insidious and Sinister.
Insidious was so big because of the jump scares.
All of these things, and like I watch them, and like I jump. I'm like But I'm not like, yay, I'm glad I'm doing this.
Yeah.
No rewatch or replay that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Next, we got Shardlight for the PC. Post-apocalyptic adventure puzzle game.
Speak of...
Sounds like a okay. bunch of keywords.
I don't know what the...
I don't really know what they're trying to shoot for here.
Yeah, this is...
But it sounds real mediocre. I haven't heard of this game.
Yeah, the post-apocalyptic thing is... We were speaking about going back to World War II and how we're all kind of tired of the future and the modern warfare. That's something that I'm... I'm tired of that setting.
But the post-apocalyptic? Yeah. I think it could be like cool for like just a shooter game. You know what I'm saying? Like how have we seen shooter games like that? That are just like a post-apocalyptic world?
Fallout?
I mean, every zombie game ever.
No, but like a multiplayer shooter game.
The Division?
It's just like semi.
New York City is kind of... That's about it.
That's fair.
Yeah.
I mean, the story of the Division was sweet. Like
Black Friday. It's not like cool. It's not really post-apocalyptic. Like,
sure,
it's just apocalyptic.
You're talking more like Fallout.
Yeah, like a Mad Max kind of like if Mad Max
Borderlands.
Yeah, but I mean, if I could shoot at someone else, and not just the fucking
the little dog,
the mongoloids and stuff.
March 10th, Death Smiles, anime style side-scrolling shoot 'em up. Play one of five angels in a gothic setting.
That sounds sweet.
I think it sounds
side-scrolling, cool. Shoot-em-up gothic, that's all you.
Yeah, that sounds real sweet.
I think it sounds cool.
I'm fine with that. Next, we got The Guest, PC. Gloomy first-person adventure mystery game set in the 80s.
Sounds sweet.
Sci-fi story. Characters being confined in a single room is kind of the setting.
That's really cool. That reminds me a lot of the Danganronpa series. What's their escape? Zero Escape, you're locked in the rooms and you need to find ways out. Those games are really hard. But also, we have like real life escape rooms now that you're literally locked in a room and you need
to.
The iEscape stickers.
Yeah,
there's one happening in Vegas. The weekend we're going, and Lindsay like wanted to do it for her birthday.
There's
so it's like $300 to be a part of it.
I'm sure it's real expensive. I think it might be Vegas. I might have to look this up.
Yeah.
They're doing the escape, like Zero Escape, the game. They're making a replica room from that game for people to escape from.
Yeah,
and I think it might be in Vegas, but I feel like it's California.
Okay.
Sounds like fun.
That could be cool. I don't personally find that fun, but,
I like the 80s setting. I think that's
yeah,
80s
are cool.
I'm too scared that I won't be able to escape and feel real bad.
I'm not a big fan of these games, but it sounds cool,
Yeah.
I don't hate
them.
I just don't enjoy playing them.
Yeah.
I'll watch people play them.
We'll make Kevin play it.
For sure.
Oh, yeah.
We'll all right. Couch.
That's what we do most of the time.
And then we'll probably turn it off and play Injustice again.
Are we playing more Injustice after this?
Sure.
The answer is yes.
Next, we got Moon Hunters for the PC. A co-op personality test top-down RPG set in ancient Mesopotamia. Unusual setting.
Very.
The world itself changes depending on your decisions. Up to four players.
Hugo Petania.
I enjoy games like this, and I think the setting's cool. Like
I like that setting.
It's very unique.
A little different.
Mm-hmm. I think it could be a sweet game.
Like Kevin pointed out earlier, it's up to four-player game, but it's a PC game.
Yeah.
Yeah, I really think that not odd, because there's people that...
I mean, online's a thing.
Yeah.
No, I mean, for sure.
Yeah, that's one of those games where I want to control
and
to sit on.
Yeah, the only problem with like something like this is there's like so many... like RPGs like Diablo, Path to Exile, some of these games going on right now that are still like big, that I don't know if like games like this are going to get attention. And this could be
it's
awesome,
hard for games to break through. And even some games that do that stuff last for like a week.
Yeah.
They're like,
there's a lot.
They're like
of
a firework.
Yeah.
They're pew,
yeah.
And then they're gone.
Especially on PC.
That should be unpopular opinion. Why I don't like fireworks.
I've never made anybody that hates fireworks but you. Next for the PC, we have Upwards Lonely Robot. Puzzle platformer game where you travel vertically up the screen through some tough puzzles. Has some story elements and co-op. More PC co-op.
Yeah.
We got
more games I won't play.
Yeah.
We should play, I think it came out last week, the Screen Cheat, the game where you're invisible and it's split screen.
We talked about playing
that
last
week.
That
sounds interesting.
Maybe we should buy that later
tonight.
The
only way to find people is actually Screen Cheat.
So yeah.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
That sounds interesting.
After Injustice.
Okay.
March 11th. Beat the Beat PC. Dubstep Shoot 'em Up. Top down shooter. Used to be a mobile game. Galaga style dubstep soundtrack. Some of your favorite things, dubstep.
I mean, if you're into cool soundtracks, I guess this could be a game.
Yeah.
Doesn't sound interesting.
Doesn't interest me. Yeah. It's no Crypt of the Necrodancer.
Yeah, man.
Yikes. I mean, just play.
I guess that was another big thing about the Nintendo game we were talking about with the crazy name. They were talking about like how cool the soundtrack was.
And oh yeah, they made a big deal about the,
so,
the soundtrack.
You know, I'm kind of excited about that.
Well, they had some big Japanese music people.
It was the people that create Pop Idols in Japan. Because in Japan,
it's all based around Japan.
Yeah, they're all produced. Pop Idols there are all produced, and people love it. Like they don't care. Unlike us, when we see things that are produced like that, we're like, oh, this is so by the books. Blah blah blah. In Japan, they're like, woohoo!
Yeah.
They're no K-pop, though.
Jeez.
Next, we got Hitman, the Xbox and PS4 PC episodic game.
Predictions for this game? Not going to do well.
Yeah, probably not at all.
The beta is free right now for anyone to download, and I'm not downloading it because I'm playing Uncharted 4.
Yeah, the Uncharted 4 beta
is up. Which is much better.
That's what we've been doing. And yeah,
minus me.
Yeah,
that's what the smart people are doing.
The Hitman. The new Hitman, like, had me at its opening trailer and then lost me when they started announcing that it was episodic and then not episodic, and then you had to pay full price, but you got the free DLC and all this stuff. And then they're like, nope, now it's just a full retail game. And it's just really
lost
my interest.
You don't like
game
companies changing their mind every, you
know, every 15
every
seconds
15 days
and not having a vision?
Yeah, it's crazy.
And I've got invited... I got invited into the alpha for this, and the beta is free or whatever, and I'm still not interested enough to even download it. No, Hitman's fine.
Hitman's fine.
Exactly. You just put the nail on the head.
It's fine.
Yeah.
I'm not playing
There's
an
so many
episodic
better games.
Hitman game.
No.
Yeah.
X-Bone PC, Ori the Blind Forest Definitive Edition.
I was so excited when they announced this.
And then?
It wasn't a physical game. It's just the digital game.
You'd really like that.
It's
game
just an expansion on. I know I will. It's just an expansion on the digital one, and I was like, they finally did. Like, they're finally bringing out the physical one. Yeah, so I think you get a discount, or they haven't announced it yet, but they're implying that you get a discount if you have game.
Yeah, you can upgrade for a reduced fee.
Yeah, but I was excited when they announced this, and then it wasn't physical. So I guess I'm gonna sit on it a little longer and hope that they announce it. And if they don't, I'll probably cave in and buy it. But because I do really, really want to play this game.
Or I have it on Steam. You can just play mine.
Sure. But I really want to check out this game. And it's killing me that they won't put out a physical copy of it. And I know the minute I buy it, they'll put out a physical copy.
It'll get announced within 5 minutes of you buying it.
Or it'll be like Life is Strange, where I wait a year for the physical copy and then absolutely hate the game.
You know, this is the worst
that's
thing.
That's kind of a bummer.
Because I would not have bought episode 2 of that game.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fair. Last but not least, WWE 2K16 for the PC.
Those games sell really well for the it's only PC? I guess it's out for everything else.
It's already been out for everything else, I think.
That's another game that people play that on PC?
I didn't know that was a PC game.
If you're into WWE, I mean, I guess they're fun. Like any other.
Those are fun games. I have like five or six.
They're fun.
They're fun.
They're fun. Yeah.
Especially when you create a character.
I was about to say,
the
I have the Joker, and I have the Hulk, and I have the Thing, and we just go online as the characters and annoy people acting like them.
We could redo Bane versus Doomsday.
And you just, you never pin people. You just keep like doing special moves on them, and you never pin them until they quit the match. What a great game.
Sounds terrible.
That's a game we should play. We should... drudge up some of the wrestling games I have and try those
just
out.
Tell me when you're doing that, and I'll make sure not to be here.
I'll make sure to leave right away.
Yeah.
I would do that.
Yeah, it sounds fun.
That's it for my releases this week.
Woohoo! All right, so let's move on to what we're currently playing. Todd kind of went off and told us what he was playing already, but that's fine. You can talk about some of those games more in depth if you want, or tell us other ones. I don't know.
I'll go first. I'll keep mine a little short.
Sure.
The new season, you know, obviously we've been playing a lot of Smite recently. It came for the Xbox, I guess, in August of last year.
Mm-hmm.
The beta did. So I've been playing it since then. I played it a little on PC on release date. You know, it's just a at first I just thought it was like a PC MOBA. But it's actually like, it's like the first third-person MOBA, which is cool. That was kind of like a cool aspect for it. And the new seasons of it just came out. So, you know, everyone's requalifying and stuff. So it's a lot of fun. Had a lot of big changes. Almost like a new game right now, so.
That's so crazy.
It's really fresh and cool to play.
They just do like patch notes and stuff, and it changes the whole game. Yeah. That's how all of them are, right?
I mean, is it an 8 gig patch? I think. So like
That's a big patch. That's big changes. Bigger than like Tony Hawk Pro Skater 5 at launch plus its patch times crazy. Two. Mm-hmm.
since August, I think there's been like 42 gigs worth of patches.
It's insane.
It's crazy. Oh. Mm-hmm. We're talking like graphic updates and stuff like that. Yeah,
the League graphics.
It's a free game as well, which is kind of cool for the Xbox.
Yeah, also, I correct me if I'm wrong, since you would know. Yeah. It's $30 and you get all the champions and all future champions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome.
That's cool.
That made me more interested in the game just hearing that, because I'm always like, well, maybe I'll like this character, maybe I'll like that. And the fact that you can basically buy a season pass or whatever you want to call it for that game was
so there's that, and then there's, you know, obviously there's in-game currency just from playing. Mm-hmm. You can buy characters with that, and then there's a free rotation every week for characters as well, which is cool. And in, like, unlike like League of Legends or like Dota or something like that, you can buy skins with like the in-game currency as well, which is kind of neat. So another cool feature. And then I've been like kind of getting off the Call of Duty like Black Ops 3 train. Mm-hmm. Just kind of getting burned out a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I see so much Call of Duty. It's all my brother plays.
That's about all I've been playing.
How about you, Kellen?
Almost done with my first Fire Emblem Faith game.
Oh yeah.
Nice.
Very close. Probably be done before this even goes up on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll be on to the next Fire Emblem.
Yeah. Good luck. And then you'll be on to the next Fire Emblem.
Yeah, probably.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll probably take a Division break in there. That'll be about it.
Fire Emblem's sweet, though.
Yeah, yeah, there's a lot of games coming out soon that it looks like I'm going to be getting.
Yeah.
I can basically name five retail games coming out in the next few weeks here that I'm going to get. I'm back on the Quantum.
The Division? Pokken?
No. Okay. I might get Pokken.
I'm actually really excited about Pokken.
Oh, well,
I might get Pokken. And, but just like Quantum Break, I know I was down on that game last week. Microsoft did their little showcase where they revealed like Ori, all that stuff that we were talking about. And they showed off more Quantum Break, and I'm back on board. The TV show integration looks sweet. Basically, I think it's a half an hour show, if I'm not mistaken. But you basically do your gameplay, and then you're going to make choices. And then you watch the game from the bad guy's perspective in live action with, like, good acting and everything. And it's like a TV show. And they act how they would act depending on the choices that you made. So they filmed the scenes multiple times and everything. And
that's cool.
Just for that alone, I'm like, I should get this game.
Yeah.
Like, that's really cool.
That's really sweet. That is.
And also, you have superpowers. And that's awesome. You have time-bending powers, which is some of the coolest superpowers you can have.
Especially in a video game.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, it's on PC, so I can play it.
That's true, too. So, I've been playing the best game of all time, Final Fantasy XIII 2. In all honesty, I'm really, really liking this game. I like it way more than 13.
It's sweet.
I like the
Mass Effect skin. I'm not going to say it's I'm not going to say it's one of my favorite Final Fantasies because I haven't beaten it yet. But I feel like when I finish this one, I'm going to go through it again. And I've looked at the DLC. I've already gotten some of it.
Yeah.
I'm going to be doing DLC stuff for this game and stick with it a little longer than I normally do. I'm not going to jump into the next one right away because I'm having so much fun with it. There's also a casino in the game where you can just gamble all your money away. So that's really fun.
I feel like we've done that before.
It's true. I talked about last week how it had a lot of Mass Effect qualities about it, and I thought that was really weird. And then I looked at the DLC, and they have Mass Effect outfits for the characters and that's Assassin's Creed outfits for the characters and all this stuff. And I was like, this is really interesting. I've been playing.
That's cool.
I've been playing that. I've been playing Mega Man 7. I beat it. Played it again. I beat it. Played it again. I beat it. I'm practicing that game because I want to do a Let's Play of it because I want to have all the Mega Man Let's Plays on my channel. Gosh, that Mega Man makes me so frustrated. That final fight is so difficult. You finally saw it when we were...
You did it in one run through.
I did it in one run because I did it 6 times before you showed up.
You didn't have any problems. You just went through it.
It was miserable. I did find out some stuff I was doing wrong, but I'm getting better at it.
Mega Man?
Yeah. I'm getting better at it, so hopefully I'll have that up in the next week or so.
That's cool.
I've been playing DDR.
You're still on the DDR train?
Yeah, I play it every once. It's so fun.
It's a game I can never get into.
And it's so fun going back because they're all songs from like my time.
Yeah.
You know, like I know all of these songs in it, as opposed to when somebody turns on Dance Central or whatever it is now and they want me to dance to somebody. I don't know who this person is.
Yeah.
Just Dance. Nobody plays Just Dance.
Yeah, man. One of the top selling games ever.
So my only problem with the DDR stuff is that my dance pad is like a skateboard, and it keeps moving around the room while I'm playing, and I don't know what I'm supposed to do.
It's
an added
feature, man. It adds another level of difficulty.
You got like the off-brand pad, though, right?
No, it's an official pad.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Yeah, and like I kept trying to think of what I could do because it's on a rug, which is the problem. I have like these sticky...
Put tape down.
I have like these sticky things, but I don't want to put them on the rug because they'll wear out in like 15 seconds doing that. And I thought I was a genius. I flipped my area rug on the back so the grip was face up. And I'm like, I'm the smartest person ever.
And the rug just moved?
And then, no. And then like 5 minutes into DDRing, I was off of the rug and back onto the normal rug. That's awesome. And I was like, oh, I'm still just sliding around.
Just nail it down.
Just quit playing DDR.
Yeah, there we go.
That's a good suggestion too. I've been playing Halo 2. We played Halo 2 last week.
We did, yeah. I forgot about that.
That was kind of fun. It was fun when we were playing it isolated.
Yeah.
But I feel like as soon as we went online, the skill levels of the people that have been playing that, because we were playing the Master Chief Collection.
Yeah.
No, I'm not complaining. I'm just saying we were playing the Master Chief Collection, and we just got murdered as soon as we went online.
I want to try that.
It was
We got
even Nick got dude. Nick was getting like legitimately mad.
Yeah, he was getting really mad. So that was sort of fun. It's always fun to go back and visit that.
Yeah,
but
it
like,
also took,
I just don't have the time
it
to.
It also took like 3 hours to download it from like 60% or something.
Yeah,
it was crazy.
That was miserable.
It's Kevin's internet.
Yeah.
No,
it's Kevin's internet and the Master Chief Collection. I still don't think that game works.
It's still broken. Yeah.
And then the other thing that I've been playing is the Uncharted 4 beta that I wanted to talk about.
Oh yeah.
What a great beta. That I put 7 hours into it yesterday.
Just yesterday.
I put about an hour into it today. I haven't played it too much today. They added a new map, which is nice. It's a...
Rooftops?
It's a rooftop map. It kind of reminds me of the museum from Uncharted 2.
Yeah.
Really like almost everything about the multiplayer in that game.
Yeah.
You go on killing spree. Like, it's just very satisfying to do well in that game. So,
so that game's pretty sweet. I know people are like going crazy about it right now.
Oh yeah, that game's gonna.
I think it looks great. I think the class customization kind of thing is sweet. It has like kind of a Gears like type of shooting feel, which I'm not like a huge fan of.
It's third person like that, so.
With that and like the rolling around, like just so much rolling around. And
well,
stuff.
It has a cover system. Yeah.
Yeah, just like Gears.
Yeah. Well, I like Gears. So.
Yeah, I know, and I think that's what it comes down to: is you like Gears or not, you like this game. But I want to play through the story mode of all these games. I hear they're really good.
They are really good.
Yeah.
They're
I've just like
very,
never
very
touched
good.
Any of them. People are like, "Oh my god, you never played Uncharted."
I hadn't done that until recently and loved
it. Yeah, he just played them like 2 months ago.
Yeah,
and then he beat them in like 4 days.
Yeah,
four days. He
very,
literally
very
skipped hanging out with us one day. He's like, "I'm playing Uncharted 2."
Yeah,
are you coming over like Uncharted 2?
That's funny.
So yeah, they're really really good.
I'll definitely try to give them a playthrough.
Super excited for 4. All right, so now, Toddley.
Oh yeah.
Do you have an unpopular opinion before?
Unpopular opinion.
Did you think about this at all? We were talking it over.
Yeah.
And you kept coming up with you came up with one that was interesting, but then you came up with another one that was Soul Calibur 2, which is your favorite fighting game.
It's actually one of my favorite video games.
And then I'm like,
people love that game.
Sure. Everybody feels that way. That's why they did an HD version of the game.
That's fair. I didn't really think about that.
No, I mean it's fine. Can you think of anything else? For an unpopular opinion?
Unpopular opinion. Yeah.
Okay, so we thought of one.
Yeah.
And what is it, Toddley?
It's the Street Fighter franchise.
What about it?
I think it's the worst fighting game franchise I've ever played.
So, obviously, it's the most popular fighting game franchise. People also, Call of Duty's the most popular shooter. I would not say it's the best shooter.
I agree.
I'm in the same boat, personally. I've played many of fighting games, not all of them. Played many of fighting games.
Yeah.
And Street Fighter, in my opinion, is the worst one that I've played.
Oh, yeah.
My least favorite, yeah.
It's definitely the least fun I've had playing a fighting game.
I agree.
Like, I've never spent so much time on a character selection screen and been so, like, bored. The characters
be like,
are so
all of these are terrible.
Yeah.
All different
not
variations
interesting.
Of the same, like, three things.
Oh, yeah. There's just really
there's
one.
Ryu.
Mm-hmm.
There's evil Ryu.
Yep.
There's another Ryu.
Yeah.
Akuma. There's a guy who's Ryu, but his name's not Ryu because it's Ken.
There's another Ryu.
There's a girl.
He
that's
doesn't
a
look
Ryu.
Like Ryu, but he has the same fighting style as Ryu.
Yeah. So part of me is And I hear it in my head already, people saying it, and it's the MOBA argument, where it's, oh, you just need to spend a lot of time and get really good at it and play it for 100 hours, and then you'll enjoy the game.
Yeah.
That's not fun.
Yeah, I mean, I mean
that sounds like the worst fighting game to me.
If I don't like it, I'm not going to put 100 hours
yeah,
into it.
Even though I've been like good at games before, like League of Legends. I was good at League of Legends, but I got a little bored, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But this is different. It's just, I don't think they're good. Like, I don't understand how they do so well.
I will back you up on that. So my problem with them personally is when I play them, I hate how everything feels like nothing flows. The moves don't flow
choppy
into
the,
each other. Choppy is a great word.
Choppy, yeah.
You, it's almost like they want you to know that frame count.
Yeah.
And the frame count of a punch is real quick. And if you do a punch and a kick, there's no, like in Tekken and stuff, I feel like when you watch those games,
it's
seems
really
like the characters are moving in a semi-realistic fashion.
That's really smooth.
And in this one, they just, it's almost like they're cutting to keyframes of the characters.
One game that does like a very good job of like the smoothness, I think, is like the Mortal Kombat games, or even like Injustice. It feels very smooth.
That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree with that. They're, I mean, obviously totally different style games, but like, Street Fighter games are all 2D fighting games. Mm-hmm. So, like, I'm used to something like Tekken that's more 3D. But even,
I've played older fighting games, you know what I'm saying? But, like, I've never liked Street Fighter. Like, my brother is, like,
I haven't either.
You know, I used to try to play with me in, like, an arcade, and I'm like, let's just go play Mortal Kombat over here because it's just a cooler game, you know?
Yeah,
I can blow someone's head off and play, Turtles in Time, sure.
So, what would you say your favorite fighting game would be?
I personally like Soul Calibur 2 a lot.
That would be your
Injustice
favorite.
Is another one. I'm just
Injustice is so good.
It's
I
so
think it's
fun.
Really underrated.
It's just fun to play.
It was a little busted when they had to patch a bunch of stuff. It's still a little busted. Competitive. I mean, there is no competitive scene
anymore. It's a little
silly
that some of the characters are just way too good.
It's got balancing issues.
Yeah, which, you know, most fighting games do. Like, there's always like four fighters in any fighting game that you see in like the pro leagues and stuff. You know.
Mm-hmm.
So Soul Calibur and Justice is good. Like obviously Tekken's really good. I'm excited for Pokken. Like
this
I haven't even played it, and it might be my favorite fighting game. I just love Pokemon.
What about you, Kellen? What are some of your favorites?
I'm a big fan of the Persona Arena games.
Yeah,
those are very fun.
Like, they're a lot of fun.
Even the like Blaze Blue games were
those were a blast.
What's cool with like Blaze Blue and like Persona, Killer Instinct games like that. I wouldn't put them all in the same category, but games like that, they're easy for newcomers to come into.
They're easy to pick up.
You can hit the same button over and over and over and do something cool and feel like you're playing the game. You play Street Fighter and you're like excited that you can go Hadouken.
Yeah.
Hadouken.
Yeah.
Hadouken.
And that's all you do.
And there's a lot of like cheap tactics that people do in Street Fighter. I feel like more so than many other fighting games. Like, I played Street Fighter with somebody and he played his one of the characters, whatever, and he just squatted down and kept hitting like the attack button and it would keep hitting me, and I was like, how do I get out of what am I supposed to do here? Like it wasn't fun. Whereas I feel like some of the other fighting games I can at least like jump and
there's
get out of it.
Yeah, there's some way to dash backwards or something like that.
And that's the thing with all of those auto combo games. When the combo's over, it normally breaks you.
Yeah, I think that's cool. With Street Fighter, you can literally keep a combo going until they're dead. It's really dumb.
They did that in Marvel vs. Capcom 3. They banned... So I was interested in playing that game, and then they banned Zero, who's the only character I wanted to play in that game.
Yeah.
I'm still kind of interested in playing it just because I never have. But he can... The thing about Zero is if he catches you, they can just kill you. If a Zero player catches you, he can instantly kill you. And that's why they started banning Cat in PlayStation All-Stars tournament play, who's the other character I play as, because she can combo, confirm, kill you from any single hit that she does.
That's crazy.
No matter any of the position, if you get hit by her, she can chain it into a combo that kills you, which I thought was cool.
Yeah.
But...
Don't
get hit.
That was one of the only problems I had with Soul Calibur is like, it's not an easy game to get into. Like you kind of have to practice because there's like 8 move combos. Like you have to do like 8 buttons to like get the combo.
I don't remember Soul Calibur enough because I haven't played it recently.
Yeah,
but correct me if I'm wrong. Is there two stances? Is there like a weapon stance and a put away your weapon stance? Does that have that or no?
Not in every Soul Calibur.
Some of them. Does 4 have that?
Mm-hmm.
5 have that?
The one that's like 4 does. The one that's introduced, like Darth Vader.
Was 4.
Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. So 4.
Sorry, I remember playing as the apprentice in 4.
Yeah. So that's when they added the weapon stance thing. And I think
I remember that.
They might have like tried to put it in certain characters in 3, but I mean I didn't really like 3. It was kind of mediocre.
Yeah, it was 2 and 4.
I have 3 downstairs.
Yeah.
I think I played it once.
It's fine. I mean, it's not. It's obviously not a bad
It's not
game.
Like Street Fighter.
Yeah. Jesus.
So, yeah, and then this new Street Fighter comes out. We've been watching some streams of it mm-hmm. and everything. And it's just, like, not a game. It's a shell of a game. There's no, like, story mode.
It
there's
feels
no,
like a demo.
It does. There's it no, like, training. Like, there's a
no
training
mode,
but, yeah, there's no arcade mode to train on to learn how to play the game. Like, the
and
only
Street
thing
Fighter's
you can do.
Always been kind of hard to get into, but this is just, like, put you into competitive play, like, instantly.
You almost have to play online. And then we were watching, and, like, the guy goes online and he's like a rank 60 something and he got put up against a 9 and it's like, oh well, this is good matchmaking.
Yeah.
That's
or even the guy
sweet.
That's unranked, he got put up against like a rank 60 or something like
that.
He just got his ass kicked.
It's so ridiculous. Yeah. Yeah, that's a Street Fighter. Like,
it also took a literal 10 minutes to get into a fight, and the fights last 30 seconds.
I mean, Street Fighter 5 is broken.
Oh, it's
as
pretty miserable.
Well, they admitted that too. But done.
I mean, that doesn't make it right.
Oh, no, that game's not
good. That's like if I rape you and I admit to it.
Well,
doesn't make it better,
it out,
does
so
it?
So it'd be out in time for a competitive play. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what
which
it
is
seems
shitty
like.
To do. They
oh,
just,
it's terrible.
They should have started working on it earlier. They rushed it for sure.
Yeah.
Which, I don't give a shit. I hate Street Fighters. They're all bad.
I'd never plan to play it, and we'll probably never play
it.
Yeah,
for sure.
So that's why Street Fighter is a bad video game. So, Todd Lee.
What's up?
You have something for us.
I do, man. I just want to, you know, I appreciate you guys having me on the podcast today.
Yes.
I got you these sweet prints.
So who's that one for?
The Marvel?
This is for Kellen over here. We got the giant size Avengers over here.
That's fucking awesome.
Hell yeah.
I like this show. I get stuff like every week now.
It's a new theme. Hey, you finally. Oh, and then I did the same thing.
And
I was going to say, you finally did what
like
I did.
A good Batman with Robin.
With Robin.
The Wonder Boy.
Probably the worst DC character.
No, that's the Flash.
I don't know about all that. Nightwing's pretty shit.
He's getting shot, so I'm okay with this cover.
It gets fucked up.
The cover is actually just a first person shooter, and Robin's getting shot.
We have the line
so.
Here, I mean, when I decide Robin must die, he dies. So,
if he
spoiler
dies.
Alert, he gets fucked up in that comic.
So, this
dies,
is getting hung
he
up
dies.
Next week.
Yeah, for sure, man.
That's pretty sweet.
That'll look good on the door.
You're my boy Wonder.
And on that note, thank you so much for watching the Press
Thanks,
podcast. Thanks for being here, Kellen.
Uh-huh.
Thanks for being here, Todd.
Anytime, man.
And thank you so much for watching.
So if you think Robin's the shittiest character and he thinks you're the boy Wonder, does that make you the shittiest character?
Good night.